All right, so it's always fun with a live demo. We're going to take a look through some of this, and I'll catalog it for you so you can have a look at it later if you need to. But we're going to be warming up to working with 2D arrays to help us manipulate images. But before we get there, of course, we need some background and a little bit of practice, and that's what today's lesson's about. Later, we will get to the actual graphical manipulation part. Okay, so first thing you need to know, some of you might have already come across this, but colors are typically stored with three components on a computer. Each ranges from 0 to 255, and they are red, green, and blue. So the mixture of red, green, and blue gives you all the colors of the rainbow, literally. With 8 bits required for each component, because that's the number of bits you need to represent numbers from 0 to 255. If you, for example, were to take a fairly small picture by now, today's standards, you'd find that a 640 by 480 picture actually has quite a bit of memory. So it's not something you could probably do in your head here, so let's go and ask how big this would be. But we're just doing the manipulation, but those of you who do go on and study this further would learn techniques to try to use memory efficiently because there is so much of it in even a small picture. So in this particular image, 640 by 480, it's 307,200 pixels in size, which is, you know, large. And bytes, well, how many bytes does each pixel require? So you got a red, a green, and a blue. Each one requires a byte. So you have 3 bytes for each of these. So you'd have this times 3. Now we know how many bytes of memory are required. So we're almost up to 1 million bytes or a megabyte. And if we wanted to know how many bits we were dealing with here, we'd have to times this by 8. So that's how many bits in the computer's memory are needed to be set aside just for this simple, small 640 by 480 image. That's why if you're not careful with using image programs, you'd easily crash the memory if you know you flooded it with all this stuff. So, I guess one small, we got pixels, bytes, bits. Anybody ever heard of a nibble? No? Well, this is the kind of people you deal with in computing science. How many bits do you think a nibble would have? This is actually a real thing. 4, because it's like half a byte, right? A nibble, a byte. Ah ha ha! Yes. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about how you build these colors. And I know we've talked about the color class in Java as far as one way that you construct colors. This is where it lives in the abstract windowing toolkit. And let's go build some colors. So this is the picture. This is the project I've uploaded for you. You can play with some of these things to run on your own. In this color chooser file, if you run it, this is what you get. Now there's many different models for storing colors. We're gonna stick with the RGB, which is this tab here. The other ones are all, you know, they're used, but this is the one we'll spend our time on. So this color chooser, we've got a few things we want to play with here. So if we were to create a red, there's 3 components in each color. So we would have red, green, and blue. So to create a red, all I have to do is knock the other components out. And this right here, 255, 0, 0, produces this color of pure, what we would think of as sort of like pure red. There's no other interference coming through it. And then similarly, if you wanted green or blue, you just shut the other channel down and you get green and you get blue. So those are the kind of things you should be able to just pull right from. You should just be able to pull that, oh, if I want blue, I'll shut the other channels out and I'll just use the blue channel on my pixel. Other things are handy to know about too. Like for example, does anybody know how you make white? And by the way, this goes along with the finger painting you did in kindergarten. You remember when you took like different colors and you, no? You guys, would, oh, you were all deprived in kindergarten. You didn't get to finger paint. Do you know what white? How would you describe white?
It's a mixture of all colors.
It is the mixture of all colors. So that means all channels are lit up full. 255, 255, 255, and there. Now I have white down here as my swatch. That's the color of all channels on full. What about black? How would you describe black? No colors. The absence of color is 0, 0, 0, and then you end up with black. So what do you think gray is? That's one possibility. So we could go 128, 128, 128, and there's the gray that you get from it. In our case, what we're gonna say is that gray is when the channels are even. So for example, I can still make gray with something like, I don't know, let's try
69.
Okay. So that's the gray that I get. Is darker. Anyone think that they could have predicted that it was darker? Why would you know that if I used 128, 128, 128, that it's going to get darker if I go 69, 69, 69? 69 supposed to be 0. And 0 represents black. That's right. It's closer to 0. 0 represents black. So that's another thing, again, if you're thinking about the way colors are constructed, it helps save you some time when you're doing that. Cyan, magenta, and yellow. Those are also some common ones. So maybe you don't know cyan, magenta, or yellow to recognize them, but let's see if you can get one of the hints here. That one? You recognize that one, right? Yes, what is it? Yellow, yes. So if we have yellow, yellow was taking the blue channel away. So sometimes we call this the complement of blue because blue has no yellow in it because we've zeroed those other channels out. So on a color wheel, blue and yellow are opposites. And when you stick all blue and all yellow together, what do you think you get? What would happen in the channels if I flooded, see right now it's all yellow, with all blue? What would come out of there? White, because they would all be at 255. So blue and yellow together make white because they're complements of each other. There is no blue in yellow, and there is no yellow in blue. Not that we need a lot of color theory here for what we're doing, but you'll certainly get there in graphics. So magenta is when we blank out the green channel. And when we blank out the red channel, we get cyan. So the printer's ink usually uses cyan, magenta, yellow because the ink that you see is actually a reflective color. So the ink that goes on the paper, when it comes up off of your eye, the color that's reflected back is everything it's not. So for example, if you are what's up here, the cyan, that means you absorb all of the light which is cyan and you reflect all of the light which is not cyan. What's not cyan? You tell me, color theorists. What's not cyan? Red. Red is not cyan, so then you know you'd get red. The reason you'd want to do this is when you put cyan, magenta, and yellow all together, you end up with a way of representing white by actually printing, and black by printing as well, if you had... so again... let me see here. Hang on a sec. Now I've confused myself. Anyway, the advantage is there in the, I think it's the black ink then. Anyway, but your printers usually use cyan, magenta, yellow, which is one reason that they're more common. And the other thing you should know about is the intensity, right? How do you increase the intensity of a color? So does anyone want to wager a guess? Like for example, how could you make this magenta less intense?
You make it less beautiful.
Okay. Oh, less alpha, yeah, okay. So we aren't gonna play with the alpha channel in our, but the alpha channel is transparency. So what you're gonna see is you end up with, yeah, actually here it's not even registered. Oh, it is, okay, it's slightly registering as it disappears. But this is like when you wanna represent graphics where you can see an object behind another, you make it more transparent. But for us, I mean, I don't want it to be transparent. I still want it to be opaque, but I don't want it to be so offensive on the eyes. Like this is a very piercing magenta right here. Or sorry, a very piercing cyan. Any other thoughts? Okay, well, let's see what happens. If I move red up, okay, yeah, that seems to work there too. The other thing, see what happens if we do this. Well, now it's getting darker, right? Because I'm getting closer to black. So if you want darker colors, you're going to be reducing the components towards zero. And when you want lighter colors, right now it's at 100, to get more light in the picture, that's a lighter version of the previous because I'm adding it closer up towards white. So lighter colors, the numbers increase in the components. Darker colors, they decrease. Okay. So now we're going to take a look at the way these are stored in a file. And this is eventually where we're headed, so you'll understand why a 2D array makes sense. So I'll pull up the Picture Explorer. And this time what I'm going to be looking at is, the beach. On a great day like today in pouring rain Vancouver. Man, it sure would be nice. Is that Hawaii? Looks like maybe Diamond Head. Anyways, this beach, the thing we're going to use it for again is to figure out the way these are actually stored in the image. So if I click, I want you to notice the row and the column will change. Like here, I'm at row 138 and column 200. So the rows are the things, meaning I'd go row 0, row 1, row 2, row 3, all the way down until I hit row 138, so the vertical. And the columns represent the horizontal as I move left and right. So if I go all the way up to the top corner here, what do you expect I'm going to have? Okay, 0, 0. Yeah, clicking in there, that is 0, 0 in fact. So 0, 0 is where we get the top corner. And in this image, it's 640 by 480. Down here, that's what I'm going to get. Well, move it over a bit, 640. How come I don't get all the way to, if the image is 640 by 480, how come I don't get all the way there? It starts at zero. So remember those off by one errors that you've been doing with arrays and things like that, you gotta be just, you know, if you know that the width is 480, you go from zero to 479. As we increase columns, we go to the right, and as we increase rows, we go down. This is why your graphics screen does it as well. So all the computer gaming stuff that we did, where you were like, why is it upside down, and that when I move my character down, I'm actually increasing Y, it's because the pixels are represented this way with row and column. Okay, let's see, what else are we gonna look at here? We've got those. So this is the way we're going to think of the representation then, as a 2D array. So let's go over what a 2D array is then, in case you've never heard of one. You can represent arrays in 1D, and that's something that we should be able to do at this point. And this is the typical one-dimensional array. A two-dimensional array reads with an extra set of square brackets, like this. This is now a two-dimensional array with three rows and five columns if I was going to represent this. It's possible you represent it differently. We'll talk about that in a minute, but this is basically a two-dimensional array. There is more possibilities. You can go up as many dimensions as you like or as convenient, but I'll be honest, if you go higher than three, it's gonna start to get a little more complicated. I'm not sure what your usage would be there. It might be more better designed to make a class to manage your data if you're going up really high in dimensions. It is fast to use the arrays, and that's one advantage of doing it over a class. But you have to have some pretty good reasons for that kind of complexity to merit, you know, that complexity for speed versus building a nice interface through a class. But anyways, in the world of programming, 2 and 3D arrays are super common. So here's the representation I want you to think about. This is a valid Java syntax for a 2D array. So again, my declaration is that I have an integer array. I'm just calling it array for the purposes of our discussion. And in it, it's an array which holds another array and another array and another array and another array. So there's actually one array that holds four arrays. That's the way Java manages this. And this is probably a better way of declaring it for you to know what's going on. This is exactly the same thing, right? If I go back one, all I did was change the white space, but this is the representation we want to think about as a table. So that the first array in there represents row number one. The second array represents row number two. So here's what it would look like then as a table if I get rid of the Java. So here are my indices and stuff for the rows, stuff for the columns. Now I'm about to blast the computer into this. Here's the computer's memory. It's going to take that first array and just stick them sequentially in memory right here, the next array right here, the next array, and so on. So you could just declare this as one big single dimensional array, but there's a convenience here. And this is where the convenience comes in. This is how you access the elements. At 0, 0, that means row 0, column 0, I'm at 41, which is that corresponding piece in the table. So again, the convenience is that you can quickly access as you mean for rows and columns in a table. So 1, 2, that gets you to 21. 2, 2 is the 13, and 3, 1 is the 52. That all connects back. So this is what we're trying to abstract things, and a picture fits really nicely with this. So here's a really lame picture. It just has some pixels. That's all I want you to think of, right? Because clearly I don't want to go over a million pixels with you to show you how to build that array. We'd be here a long time. This is what I would think about it if I was thinking about these pixels as an array, right? The computer's memory doesn't actually store colors, it stores bits and bytes. So rather than seeing red as this first pixel, I think about it as an RGB pixel with a red channel, no blue green. I think about it as a green, so I think about it as a green. So these are the table of values that represent the pixels. And in Java, it would be a pixel array, and the data would be this stuff. The first row, here's my array for the first row, red, green, and blue. Then white, gray, and black. White, gray, black. So that's the abstraction we're trying to make here as you work with an image. So here's the one caveat that you need to know about. It's a terminology thing, and don't worry, the consistency, we will always go this way, which is row major representation. What it means is that all data for the first row is stored before the next. So in the computer's memory, if I just back up here to show you that picture, here is all of row number one. Here is all of row number two. So I'm storing rows in this array. That's the other way I guess you could think about it. So here it is, store the whole row, the row gets stored. The next row gets stored. Now, in our course, that is the way, as well as the advanced placement exam. You can assume, if you're not told, that it's always going to be this way. However, it is possible to do column, if there's an advantage there, if you think it's easier for something you're programming. Column major means the columns come first. So here's a table of values. I could represent it several ways. Here is the row major representation. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So in memory, the first row, the second row. The first position in the array is the first row. The second position in that array is the second row. So in Java, here it is, the first row, second row. That is the row major representation. But if for some reason you thought it'd be more convenient to go column row, this is the representation then. That column, 1, 4, before this column, 2, 5, before 3, 6. So now it looks like this. You have an array with three columns, and here's the data in each column. So the Java would look like this. Column 1, column 2, then column 3. But again, just for clarity, we will always do row major, and you can assume that it's row major you'll be working with. So here's some shortcuts in case you want to refer to some of the 2D array stuff that you'll be doing, accessing, creating, those kinds of things. As well, down here, these are valuable things to think about. In row major, the outer array will tell you how many rows are there. So if you ask for the outer array's length, you'll end up with the number of rows. If you grab one of the columns, that is, for example, the first array inside the array, that'll tell you how many columns are in there. So that's one shortcut that gets you the number of rows and columns. as we loop through this stuff, we're going to be doing a lot of very typical looping where you just burn through an entire array. So some of you have encountered this, but now again for clarity, it is an expectation that you are also introduced and know how to use an enhanced for loop. If you've already seen it, great. But it literally is an enhanced loop. It is a nice thing to use. You will like it. The programming pattern that you're used to, start at zero, go to the length, increment each time, and print it. This can be abbreviated with a for each or an enhanced for loop. So what this says is, for every integer in my array, print it. It's convenient because it literally goes through each one from beginning index to end index. But there are limitations, obviously. It goes through every element exactly once. There's no way to stop this loop and say, oh, you're done, jump out of the loop. There's no way to go backwards. There's no way to do every second. You literally have to go through everyone from first to last. So it's the only time it works, but when it does work, it's great because it also avoids missing an item or going past the end. Java takes care of all that just by doing this sort of an array. We're using integers in the examples, but this could easily have said string item and be in a string array. Whatever the array holds, that's what you're declaring it as here instead of integer. And this is how you will refer to it when you use it for calculation in your loop. So in my loop, the only thing I do is I print it. So that's why it reappears there. Okay? So in our upcoming assignment, that is an expectation that I have to see enhanced for loops there. Not for every loop, because again, they're limited in their scope, but I should see you using them so that I know that's something you're familiar with. AP exam, again, will use code that has it, and if you're not seen it before or used it, then you might get thrown off by that. So here's our first exercise. Again, all we're doing is trying to familiarize you with the idea of what a 2D array is and how it can be used. So I'm going to use a math idea called the matrix. Not the cool movie. I mean, the first one's super cool, second one kinda cool, third one, okay. I kinda got lost by that point, but I'm talking about the math. So for those of you who go on to take linear algebra, you will end up learning about matrices. And this is going to represent some of the things we do with them. So this is basically the way we were going to represent a matrix in Java, is you give it me a 2D array, and then I will make a copy of those values in the 2D array, and I'll be prepared to do some of these math operations I'm about to show you. So in your constructor, you give me a 2D array, and you must copy them over. So this might be the first time you're hearing about this, but this is called a deep copy when you reallocate all the memory and copy everything over to a new object. It's called a shallow copy when you just assign the value. So if I was to do this, the values in my class are just equal to the values you gave me. All I did was point to the same memory everyone else is using, and it's a shallow copy, a shared resource. The danger there is you're no longer the only object in control of that. It may become inconsistent if someone changes it when you didn't expect. So if it's important that you have ownership over the data and control it, then you need to make a deep copy. So you will create a loop that builds the 2D array and assigns all the values by simply copying them over. You should be able to tell me how many rows and columns are in this and not have to store them. Hint, hint, we already talked about where you might find that shortcut in these notes. You need to write a toString method for me. This is my suggestion. You can adapt it to something else convenient. But basically, if this was the 2D array that I was representing, this is the matrix that I would be able to print. So here's the strings in Java. 1, tab, 2, then the bracket, new line. That's what I get here for the matrix when I print it. Okay? Rows and columns sort of representation. So if you think yours is more eye-appealing, great. Do it the way you want to. Okay, so here's where the matrix math comes into play, and I'm not going to go into great details here. I'm going to give you more of the mechanics because you're not responsible for a math test here, but you will have to do the mechanical end of things with this matrices. So scalar multiplication is when you take a matrix and you multiply it by a number. So 2 times a matrix means you simply double everything in there. So 2 times all the values, and now I end up with this new matrix. Okay? So you'll just loop through every entry in that matrix and apply that multiplication. So here's the heads up for you. Nothing in this class will be changed. You always create a new matrix and give it back. So don't alter the existing values. You will simply create a duplicate matrix that then has the new values in it and return a new matrix. This is like the string class. Strings always provide you the newest version if you ask for a substring of it. It doesn't cut it down, it gives you a substring back. If you ask for, you join two strings together, that doesn't push the memory together, that literally gives you a new string that joined them together. This is a fancy term, but it's called immutable, when an object is never changed. And this class will be immutable, meaning there are no methods to alter it once it's been created. You can always guarantee that no matter what method you've applied, the existing matrix is the same, but you can return a new one to me, okay? We'll talk about that later in the course because it does appear as far as understanding, like, why didn't this change? If you know the class is immutable, like strings, then it's easy just to look at the code and say, well, there's no lasting changes because the strings never change. But anyways, you'll see that again here when we add. You take another matrix, so give me the parameter, add it to this matrix. You will then return to me a new matrix that represents the mathematics that's involved. So how do you add two matrices? It's the intuitive way you would think. You take the position here and add it with the position here. The positions need to match up in order to add everything in the matrices. So the new matrix I get back looks like this. And that should tell you something right away. It's very important that you have the same amount of rows and columns or it won't work. So before you even bother trying to add, you should do that error check. And how do you return something failed? Well, in our case, it's going to be null, right? Return a matrix that doesn't exist. It's undefined if they don't line up the way these have. Subtraction, exactly parallels addition. So that one minus that one is now just subtracting the values. Multiplication is a little trickier, which is one of the things I did want to talk to you about. You're basically going to take a row and multiply it onto a column. And that's the way the loop is going to work. So let me show you what I mean. This goes to the position you'd expect. But the next one is going to keep going down the column and keep going down the column. So this row here has been taken out and multiplied onto this column piece by piece. So what it would look like is this, 1 times 3, 2 times 2, 3 times 1. So the new value of that result would be 10. That's what goes in the resulting matrix. Okay, so again, the next time I would do it, row on column goes like this. And that's the math that comes out of that. 1 times 6 plus 2 times 5 plus 3 times 4. So you end up with 28. So I did put an animation in here so you could try to follow it along. Good to try doing this with pen and paper so that you understand the process. I shouldn't say that. So that you can replicate the process. You're not responsible to understand how this math works, but to implement it in Java, you are. So I know this is a daunting task. Because it's like, how do you flip these things and turn them around? So let's talk about that. First of all, here's the preconditions. The columns have to equal the rows in the left to the right matrix because you're flipping one to the other. It won't work unless that happens. Similarly, the rows in the left matrix have to be the same as the columns in the right matrix. So return null if any of those fail because you can't multiply two matrices that way. The resulting matrix, the one you're building, hint, hint, has these rows and columns. It has the number of rows from the left matrix and the number of columns from the right matrix. So again, you create this new matrix. Now you know how big it's going to be when you're done. So this is a challenging problem, and good programmers take those challenging problems and break them down into more manageable ones. So here's my manageable suggestions for you. Feel free to do your own. But you probably want to break it down rather than tackle the whole thing at once. So here's what I think of when I'm doing this. Okay, I have to be able to get a row and get a column and treat them as I've extracted them out. Because if I can pull those things away, I no longer have to think about the entire matrix. I can only look at the row and column. And the fact that the column goes vertical, that's a challenge too. I'd rather just extract the whole thing and have two arrays that I can work with. So I'm gonna write a method that gets me a row. You tell me what row, I'll extract it from the matrix and throw it into an array for you. You tell me what column you want, I'll extract that column and I will throw it into an array for you. Then the dot product is actually the linear algebra term for what you're doing. All I'm going to do is take corresponding indices now, index 0 for the row with index 0 for the column, multiply it, add that to index 1 times column 1, row 2 times column 2, plus, and keep going in a simple loop. So at this point, the dot product should be a lot easier to implement. That is now the value that goes in the new matrix. So I would have three subtasks, and I would check each one individually to make sure I'm able to do those. So here's what it would look like then, if you follow what my breakdown of this problem is. I could now take the original example I gave you and say, using my methods, that would be to take the left matrix, get a row, the right matrix, get the column, and take their dot product, I should get 10. That now goes in the result. So the loop is going to be more typical over all the rows and the columns as well. Another method that you need to be able to implement is to transpose a matrix. That literally means the rows become columns, columns become rows. It gets flipped. So in an example, that would be here the row 1, 2, 3 becomes column 1, 2, 3. The column 1, 4 becomes the row 1, 4. So you're just making a copy where the number of rows is switched with the number of columns. And instead of going row directly to row, the row gets put into the column of the new matrix. Okay, so why would we do all these methods? Just to give you an idea what matrices are used for, there's huge applications in linear algebra, but one of the most common is to solve systems of linear equations. You don't have to do this. I've done all the extra work. You can look at some of my code, but this is, if you think about it, it's three matrices in this system of equations. One which represents the coefficients, another which represents the variables, and another which represents those constant terms on the other side of the equal sign. Because if I take these now and I turn it into some math, I actually end up being able to say this times this will give me these two constants here. And it actually will fit in the matrix, because if I flip this, I'll get 2x plus 3y, and that's what I had originally, 2x plus 3y equals 1. Now, again, I've done all the work here in solving for you. If you do move this matrix to the other side, it's similar to the algebra you already know. The inverse matrix, or you could think about it like the reciprocal matrix, it's more complicated than that. When I move it over, now I can figure out the solutions for x and y. So if I was to apply this new math, I would get negative 1 and 1. Which are the solutions to that system of equations. So all of that I've coded for you in a file which I'm calling matrix.java. So you have to fill in the empty methods. So as you look through the code, there's something that I coded for you. If you fill in the rest, we'll get to the culmination where you'll be able to create a method in main to solve systems of equations. So you'll use my code with yours, and you'll be able to say, please enter the coefficients, please enter the constants, the solution to your equation is, and be able to solve systems up to as big as you would like. Okay? So that is the goal by the end of this, that you have a computer program that solves systems of equations. If you fill in my parts of the code, it should do that for us. All right, off we go.